と思います。
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
As my first official act as your pastor, it is indeed my pleasure to welcome you to this solemn service of ashes as we celebrate our lives, but also remember that we are ashes, that we are dust, and it is from dust that we come. Just a few words of instruction during this welcome time. The absolute opposite of what I discussed this afternoon with one of the ushers. We're going to have the ushers escort you down and lead you at the end of the service down the outside aisles, opposite of what I said. That will happen a lot over the years. I will always admit it, that it was my mistake. You'll receive your ashes either on your forehead or on your hand, your outstretched hand, so we'll know. Then you will leave in silence out the center aisle. The choir will be first in that imposition, and they will be leading you out. Would you stand now, please, and join me, if it's possible for you. If not, stay down. The call to celebration. The season of Lent calls us to journey along the edge to anticipate that final trip to Jerusalem.
Lent calls us to the cutting edge, when the wheat falls to the ground and new life comes forth.
Lent not only calls us to give up something, but also invites us to participate in the mystery of God with us.
By your grace, call us from grief into gladness, despair into hope, estrangement into right relations with each other and with earth.
Let's sing. Echo in our ears? Are they the words of our consumer culture with catchy jingles and clever rhymes? Are they the words of our past, remembering every put down, every angry word? Are they the words of our inner doubts, where we hear that we will never amount to anything?
Holy One, open our ears to your words. Let us find comfort for our needs, hope for challenge for our journey. Let us hear blessings and love enough to drown out the cheap temptations. Give us reassuring words to face our fears and follow Christ along the path to the cross. Amen.
O Lord, hear our humble prayer. Amen.
I invite you to turn to the back of the hymnal. The page number is the small number at the bottom of the page, page 642, or if you have your handout from the dinner, you have it there. This is Psalm 32. It begins with the sung response. Would you play it through one time, please, Zonda, and then we'll sing. And we'll sing every time there's a little R there.
Steadfast love surrounds those who trust in God.
Happy are those whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom God imputes no iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. While I kept silence, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of summer.
Steadfast love surrounds those who trust in God.
Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to God, and you, O God, forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you. At a time of distress, the rush of mighty waters shall not reach them. You are a hiding place. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with glad cries of deliverance.
Steadfast love surrounds those who trust in God.
I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Do not be like a horse or a mule without understanding, whose temper must be curbed with bit and bridle, else it will not stay near you. Many are the torments of the wicked, but steadfast love surrounds those who trust in God. Be glad in God and rejoice, O righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart.
Steadfast love surrounds those who trust in
God.
Some of you may recall that on December 4th, I made a comment about the bell choir, because when I heard the bell choir was going to play, I thought back over my years of ministry, and I said there are only two kinds of bell choirs, really good and really bad. You have a really good bell choir. Several weeks ago, I got a note, maybe from Gene and Ellen, that they were going to be using, I think they used the word kids in the service more. And they said, we're going to have a flute solo. And I said, oh dear, there are only two kinds of flute players. Flautists. Is that right? Flautists? Yeah. Done my homework. Really good and really bad. Thank you for being really good. That song would have seemed 20 minutes long if you'd been really bad. It was a joy to hear you and see your passion. Thank you. And you were good too. Our lesson from the Psalter this evening is from Psalm 51, the first 17 verses. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgression. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I'll be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore me to the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your way so that sinners will turn back to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God. You who are God my Savior. And my tongue will sing of your righteousness. Open my lips, Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. You, O God, will not despise. They didn't believe anyone still cared, but people did. And now, those aforementioned people, they're all busted. One of them was Howard Mechanic, a man who was convicted in 1970, and a few of us can remember 1970, for anti-war activity, who then spent 30 years in hiding. Calling himself Glenn Treadway, he lived a quiet life in the classy, conservative town of Scottsdale, Arizona. Then Treadway decided to run for city council. Bad move. Local newspaper reporter came asking questions for a standard candidate profile. It's a normal thing for the press to do. He told her all of his secrets, and then he asked her not to tell anyone. Not particularly bright. You see, here's what Howard Mechanic thought. After 30 years, everybody would have forgotten 1970. He'd even forgotten how to spell his real middle name. He sort of hoped that the government, who never forgets anything, would have forgotten about his crime. Well, he's now doing many, many years in a federal lockup. But Howard Mechanic is not the only fugitive to surface after many, many years in hiding. Abby Hoffman, sound familiar? Surrendered after 6 years of posing as an environmentalist named Barry Freed. Black Panther accomplice Catherine Ann Power turned up as a restaurateur named Alice Metzinger. Symbionese Liberation Army member Kathleen Solia. She was found living as a doctor's wife named Sarah Jane Olson. Bernadine Dorn emerged from nowhere after a decade underground. Does it seem like no one knows how to be a fugitive anymore? You think that after a while, ollie-ollie in free is correct? That you can just come out of the darkness? Again and again, people fail in their attempt to completely discard one life and then dress themselves in another life. And of course, perhaps some fugitives secretly hope that their sins will surface. Maybe they want to come out of the darkness. So they pull a kind of a self-destructive move like telling a newspaper reporter that you are a fugitive from justice. Or maybe they just find it impossible to live a life without a past. So they let their current identities link up with their former selves. I guess these fugitives and others like them thought that after 10 or 20 or 30 years, people just wouldn't care. Well, guess what, folks? People cared. And so does God. It is to the psalmist David's credit that he was not interested in being a fugitive fool. You heard those words I read. He came clean. He, in great, great language, said, I'm guilty. I'm a bad guy. Take me. Use me. He longed to come clean with God and said, I know my transgressions. My sin is ever before me. My sin is ever before me, whether it is the lobbing of a cherry bomb at firefighters in 1970, that was Howard Mechanic's crime, or the losing of your temper with a friend in the year 2001. Sin is sin, and it isn't going to go away even if you hide for a while. And then you come back out thinking, ollie, ollie, in free, all is well. You see, David the shepherd knew this long before the campus protests of the 1970s when I was a college student, before Vietnam turned into chaos and even turned into a crime. In today's text, David turns himself in and says, I'm guilty. Create in me a clean heart, he says, and put a new and right spirit within me. We are here this evening because it is important to come clean for yourself, for those you've wronged, for the people around you. It's important to come clean. The movie Running on Empty a few years ago, which picked up a couple of Academy Award nominations, and by the way, in the day when the envelope you got was the correct one with the right information in it. That movie tells the story of a couple who bombed a napalm lab in California in 1971 and accidentally left an innocent person blind. Ever since, now raising a family, they've been fleeing from the FBI, frequently changing their identities, their residence, and the story focused on Danny, their oldest son, and on the difficulties he and his siblings had when they couldn't ask mom and dad about where'd we come from? Where were we born? They got no good answers from mom and dad. David tells us that sin is not just between you and God. It is of social dimension. It reaches out. It wraps itself around relationships with significant others, with relatives, with friends, with neighbors, with children. And the only way to get untangled is really simple. Is through repentance and confession. And that's why we're here tonight. By coming clean with God and with the community. Otherwise, you remain a fugitive fool no better than Howard Mechanic. Let's go back to Howard just for some fun. Howard had lived a life that was bizarre for 30 years. He lived on the lam. He married a woman in 1980. Together, they had a child. And when she asked him, which name shall we give the child? Which last name? Yours or mine? He quickly said, yours. He hated his identity. He did not want this child to bear the name that he had hidden. This perplexed his wife, and since she knew nothing about his real identity, she agreed. Later, after that marriage ended in divorce, he fell in love with another woman, and she was, ready for this, a left-thinking, non-smoking vegetarian. Social activist, and the two became a couple. She loved everything about Treadway from the start, except for one thing. She didn't like his name. She even called one of her friends and said, I think we're going to get married, but I just hate the name Gary. See, that isn't who he was. If she only had known who he really was. The tangles get tighter and tighter, and as a fugitive, they're forced to live a lie. And then Treadway decides to run for city council, and that young lady, cub reporter, showed up with 15 questions. Well, tell me about yourself. Where are you from? What'd you do? All this. Just doing her job. Tell me about your family. Where'd you grow up? He told her he was an orphan, and that he didn't want to talk about it. And she said, tell me three stories about your life. Now he starts to sweat. He made up a whole bunch of stuff about a life. 3 days later, and that is not insignificant, 3 days later, he called her and said, none of the stuff I told you is true. And then started the unfolding that became his coming out from his life as a fugitive to his life as a penitent soul. At the moment of confession, the fugitive begins to break free. As a word of truth is spoken, the many tangles of long-lived lies and tortured lies, they begin to fall away. When a penitent sinner makes a sacrifice acceptable to God, a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, then the process of divine blotting and washing and cleansing begins to happen. I've lived long enough to know that nothing good can really happen without the truth. No cleansing can take place unless you put aside your fugitive foolishness and confess the truth about really who you are and whose you are. You've got to say, you're not who you think I am. I'm really not the person you think you know. And when we do that, we won't be busted. We'll be forgiven. You see, God is not a lawman, not looking to slap the cuffs on us And while the FBI may want to lock up criminals, God desires to set sinners free. God isn't about to bust us, but instead to blot us. Blot out transgressions. This evening, we have the opportunity to take a moment to give up our foolish, fugitive lives and give an accounting for who we really are. To say to the Lord God, I know my transgressions, my sin is ever before me. Against you, you alone have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence. God knows exactly what we've done, even after 30, 40, shall I go on? 50, many years of running and hiding. God's not interested in punishment. God wants to free us, through forgiveness. Amen.
Dust and ashes touch our face, mark our failure and our falling. Holy Spirit, come. Walk with us tomorrow. Take us as disciples, washed and wakened by your calling. Take us by the hand and lead us. Lead us through the desert sands. Bring us living water. Dust and ashes soil our hands, greed of market, pride of nation. Holy Spirit, come. Walk with us tomorrow as we pray and struggle through the meshes of oppression. Dust and ashes choke our tongue in the wasteland of depression. Holy Spirit, come. Walk with us tomorrow, through all gloom and grieving, to the paths of resurrection. Take us by the hand and lead us. Lead us through the desert sands. Bring us living water. Holy Spirit, come.
I invite you now to reflect in silence what it is that you've brought this evening. that you want to leave here with God. Shall we pray? Gracious God, we are called from grief to gladness, from darkness into light. Help us move and be moved into right relationships with you and with each other. Amen. Now, as we prepare to depart from this place as sinners set free, know that we are dust. From dust we come, and to dust we return. Let us go in peace. Amen.